Okay, started to record. Let me just directly go to share. Okay, so some pretty important. Okay, can you see? Can you see?
Yeah, we can see, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay, so some very important clarification that I think was not. I think there was a bit of a. An issue there yesterday. So see what we did yesterday was basically we took the wave equation, okay, and from that we kind of constructed this sort of relationship between. Acha, so very importantly, we are working in. So okay, for first things first. So in an anisotropic crystal. Is essentially any material crystal, whatever it is, something where the properties of the material or the crystal are not the same in all directions, right? However, what we saw also that you know, if we want to get the continuity equation working, then there some conditions are imposed on the dielectric tensor. So essentially, the fact that the things are properties are not equal in all directions. Leads to the fact that the dielectric constant is no longer a dielectric, whatever, yeah, it's no longer a constant, but it is a tensor which is having so 9 possible components. However, the requirement of the satisfaction of the continuity equation leads to the fact that the dielectric tensor has to be symmetric, okay? And we are able to diagonalize it, and we go to something called the principal axis coordinates, where you have now three equivalent, three sort of values of the dielectric constant epsilon x, the diagonal values, that is, obviously, and they are representing the properties of this crystal into the three orthogonal directions, x, y, z. Those are called the principal axis, very important. And taking the wave equation, we constructed this kind of a relationship where we have this this kx, nx, ky. So we sort of wrote it down in terms of the wave vector, and the refractive index is nx is the refractive index corresponding to the principal axis x. This is very crucial. Nx, Ny, Nz are the solutions of the, or rather the, you know, the when we take the wave equation, essentially considering the fact that we have an anisotropic medium, and when we cast it in the principal axis coordinates, this relationship pops up, and so this is basically cast down in terms of the refractive indices of the material in the three principal axis directions. What is n? N, however, is the refractive index which light encounters when it enters the medium. Very important. Please listen to this very carefully. N is what the light or what electromagnetic wave when it enters the medium. This is what it encounters, and these three, nx, ny, and nz, are the refractive indices of the material in the three principal axis coordinates. So essentially what we have is N1 and N2. These are solutions. So this is what we basically have when I said that there are two possible solutions. Those are solutions for N. NX, there is only one. I think there was a bit of confusion yesterday. Nx is the principal axis refractive index. The solution is for N. So N basically has a pair of solutions, N1 and N2. Very importantly, there is this particular direction of K or this wave vector where N1 and N2 are the same. That is what we mentioned repeatedly yesterday, that if you have the direction of the wave along that axis called the optic axis, light will encounter a single refractive index. Very crucial. And this N1 square, basically, we have two like N, you know, solutions there. And this basically can have two sort of, you know, N1 and minus N1 as well, which basically means that if you have a negative solution, that means that that corresponds to a wave which is traveling in the, so the K is sort of the opposite direction as compared to the incident direction. That is the meaning of the whole thing. Is this clear? This is very important. We are absolutely not solving for Nx. We are solving for N. And you get, because it's a quadratic, you get N1 and N2, which are essentially, you know, they can be different from each other. Generally, they will be different from each other, except for the fact that there is a particular direction when they are the same. That is called the optic axis. Okay, questions?
Sir, I just wanted to confirm that. Yesterday, we concluded that along the optic axis, N1 and N2 are equal.
Exactly. That is perfectly fine.
And you said something about the kx square, ky square, and kz.
That is basically, yeah. So that then it doesn't make any sense. So in the sense that you see, when you have n is the same as this thing, then when you resolve this k into these three, they are all the same. See, the incident k also you can sort of break into kx, ky, kz, right? So that also does not make any difference. This is same. That is what makes sense.
All three directions.
Yes,
also it is same. And both the solutions are also same.
Right. That is the crucial part. I think we got a bit confused yesterday when Hitesh asked about, you know, all this quadratic and four roots. And so we are not solving, absolutely not solving for Nx square. That's a fixed for a material. This is not fixed. This is basically dependent on direction. So when you solve for this, you will get a combination of this and that. Okay, so that will basically give you, and now what we are going to look at is, you know, we are just going to sort of wind this part up by saying that okay, what we are going to essentially see is if you have any polarization which is along these orthogonal, you know, principal axes, kx, ky, and kz, then you essentially will have basically D and E will be parallel. If you have arbitrary polarization, you basically will get that arbitrary polarization will get divided into two mutually orthogonal polarizations. And the D1 and D2, those D1 dot D2 will be basically zero. That is what we're going to show today. And we are also going to show today that the pointing vector that we have, that is no longer in the direction of K, which is extremely important for, and I mean, non-isotropic media or anisotropic media. That is very, very crucial. Okay, so this I have actually, updated these things, which I did not have yesterday. But this part, basically this was the same, but this part I, in fact, on the net also I have updated. And by the way, if you look at the older notes, 17th September, you know, we discussed that, that plasmon, that Debye, this thing. Screening, right? So there we had that n^(1/3), n^-1/3, all that controversy. So I've actually changed that slide. I have put in that derivation that Bishwajit actually provided. So that also you will find. It is updated in the net, in the drive. Okay. So what we will start today is basically very important part. That is the orthogonality. So this is clear, right, everybody? So this is the absolute basics of anisotropic media. This is what I just now said. The principal axis essentially gives you a set of refractive indices. If you have arbitrary polarization, what you will essentially have is it will split into two orthogonal polarizations and they will travel with different phase velocities. The phase velocities will correspond to the refractive indices Nx and Ny or whatever, Ny, Nz or something like that. And that is what essentially gives you the phase shift. I mean, sorry, this rotation of polarization when the beam emerges into the, you know, the medium from which it entered the crystal. You will have a recombination and then what you have is a rotation of the polarization vector for appropriate conditions, of course. Okay, so orthogonality of D vectors for a given wave vector. This is very crucial. Okay. So what we will do is we will, so essentially what I'm trying to show is we have an input wave that is traveling as usual in the z direction, and we will consider polarization in the x direction. What we shall show is that inside the crystal, it is possible, you will basically have equivalent descriptions of polarization in both your x direction as well as in the y direction. Okay, so you will basically, you can see that if I come in with the x direct, I mean, so if it is along the principal axis, of course, then there are certain things. If it is not along the principal axis, you will get split, the polarization splits into two orthogonal polarizations. Okay, so we will initially consider a monochromatic wave, chromatic wave traveling in the z direction and polarized in the x direction inside an anisotropic crystal. Okay, so basically, you know that if you want to construct a wave equation, right, for the wave inside that, inside this, okay. So we would like to construct a wave equation. Now remember that this is traveling in the z, and it's polarized in the x. Okay, so you obviously we will look at the del cross E, that equation. If we look at del cross E and the del cross H, those equations, remember that the finite term that will come essentially because it's moving in the z and it has ex, right? So we shall essentially consider the y component of this, and that obviously will be equal to the y component of the magnitude. That is fine. So why this? Because this gives you basically del ex del z, right?
Sir, this polarized direction is of the T vector, right?
See, at the moment I'm just saying that there is a wave, yeah, okay, I mean, which is traveling in the, yeah, I mean, obviously what is crucial will be the D vector. We will show that the field that is, the orthogonality of two vectors, when we resolve them, the orthogonality will be maintained only between the D vectors. That we shall show.
Actually,
Okay,
I'm trying to
orthogonality will be
understand.
along D.
What do you mean by when you say polarized in x direction? That I'm trying to understand.
No, so polarized in the x direction, so basically if you have, no, that is okay, right? Because you are going like that and you have something like this, right? So this is z and the electric field is in this direction. Now, the displacement vector is also, I mean, okay, so at the moment
So
we are
you're assuming
considering,
that x direction is a principal
yeah,
axis,
exactly. It is
then
like a
it will
principal
be
axis.
in the same direction.
Right. Yes, correct. Oh, okay. You are already, yeah. That makes it
Oh, okay.
simpler. That makes it
Okay.
very simple. If I consider the principal axis, then x and e and d are the same. It is when I do not consider the principal axis when that they become different.
Yes.
Okay, that is the issue. That is the very crucial issue. Okay. Yeah, so then this is basically del h y del t. And for the magnetic depth, so y money, this one will basically be x, this thing, minus epsilon naught epsilon x del ex del t, which gives you del h y del z, ex ka corresponding h y, which is minus epsilon naught del ex del t. Okay, So yeah, so basically what absolutely, so let me just write it down. So x, y, z, they are corresponding to the principal axes of the, this is crucial. Oh, this is very, very, very crucial. Okay. System. So essentially what I get then, this is very simple, right? So then I will just take a do double derivative and I get just then. So from here, I just take a, this will basically give me del square ex del z square equals mu r mu zero. Your this is just del del t del h y del z, which should happen now, guys. So that basically means I have this just del square ex del z square equals epsilon x from here, epsilon 0 mu r mu 0 del from this one del square e del t square. Okay, so what we now have from here is we have wave velocity, which is given by, which I think it's better to write as v. Again, let me not mess up. V squared equal to 1 by root of epsilon x, epsilon 0, mu r, mu 0. Right? And obviously, you have the solution here. This has a solution, which is obviously Ex is some E0x e to the minus I omega t minus kx z. Absolutely fine. Okay, and
Is
this
there a
keyboard,
minus sign
where?
in the
No,
del
it's okay.
x by del z on the
No.
right hand side? Okay,
No, it's
got
okay,
it.
right? Both are minus, right? So it's okay.
Okay.
Both are minus, right? So this kx is root of omega epsilon omega by v, right? So you will see that Davis has everything, but they just absolutely, they just write down answers. Okay, so I am actually, I think the in thing math is good. Just write down these answers. Okay, this is in very crucial. So what we basically have is wave propagates along the z direction with phase velocity vx that is equal to your c by nx, and obviously your nx is root of epsilon x, where this is the principal axis, this thing. Now, what is very important is even for the same propagation along the z direction, you can absolutely get a very equivalent description of polarization along the y direction. So essentially, what we are trying to say is, if you have propagation along the z direction, you can have both solutions which have polarization along x as well as along y. So both solutions are possible, and they are absolutely similar. Only the phase velocities are different. See, this does not matter if you have the input k vector along one of the kx, ky, kz. Then there is no problem. The thing is, when you have an arbitrarily oriented wave, which is arbitrary with respect to the principal axis, it is then that it gets to components orthogonal, and it takes into two possible, because both are essentially possible solutions. So then when you have an arbitrary thing coming in, you basically have, okay, very critical. So let me just write that down. So
Sorry, your voice is breaking.
said, what the hell can I, horrible. Okay, so the light hasn't flickered. Tell me if I'm breaking or not breaking. I mean, but I don't know if this internet. Can you hear? Oh, huh?
We can, but it is breaking after every 1 second.
Man, like, oh, right. So I'll just write down some stuff. I'm writing down, because it's not broken. Shall I rejoin? I don't know. Generally the light flickers once. Now it's fine. No, Bishwajit, you are also at Izer, so you will not understand. No, the people who are outside Izer will understand.
It's fine now.
Is it fine?
Okay. It is fine, yeah.
Okay. Now wave propagating along Z may also be polarized along Y direction with phase velocity Vy given by C0, okay, and C0 I wrote, oh, given by C by NY, where your NY is again absolutely the same, right? So basically what we are trying to say, let me just start a fresh slide. Yeah. So what we are trying to say is a wave along the Z direction will have two allowed polarization directions with very crucially different phase velocities. And this is again, whatever direction you propagate, again, this same thing will hold with x, y, x. If it's in going in the x direction, then you can have polarization in y, z, whatever, same. When it doesn't matter, this, you know, I mean, x, y, z can be completely arbitrary. But the crucial thing, as Anirudh said, that is, in case the direction of propagation is along the principal axis, then the polarization polarization is along the other two, and this implies that E is parallel to D. Very crucial. And of course, however,
E is parallel to D only when, even though, like, the direction of propagation is one thing, and also the polarization is also important. If the polarization is along the other principal axis, then only E is parallel to D.
Ha 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 ha. That is
like if Z is the direction of
propagation. Yeah, you are right. Very correct. This is not then. And. And is important. It is not then. And. And the polarization is along two. That is crucial. Right? So if you have random this thing, then it's absolutely correct. So what are you saying, that if the direction of proposition is along principal axis, and if you have randomly polarized, then for example, you have some other kind of polarization.
Like a 45-degree polarization.
Correct. Completely agree. It is absolutely right. 45-degree polarization will not have parallel to D. So it is not then, and the polarization along the two. Very crucial. Thanks for that.
So however, as I said, two, as in like either of the two, is that what you mean?
माने ईवाई और ईजेड बट दैट वी आर सी या
माने इन द प्लेन ऑफ द अदर टू
या माने इन द प्लेन माने दैट इज व्हाट अलोंग माने आई मीन इन इन द प्लेन आई मीन सो यू हैव वन ऑफ द पोलराइजेशंस
नो नो नॉट अलोंग
सो इफ यू नो इट इज हैज टू बी अलोंग एक्चुअली
हां
नॉट इन द प्लेन माने but it is it has to be along the thing
along
no in the plane can be arbitrary angle anirudh orbit in the plane can be arbitrary angle that is not allowed right in the plane does not mean along the axis it can be random angle no
yeah that's what my
along mane okay along means basically in the direction of the other two not in the same plane it is exactly along though so let me write exactly
yes sir
exactly that is important
sir can you please repeat how did we conclude that the wave traveling inside will have two allowed polarizations
so in the sense that what we see saw now is no so these are allowed solutions I am saying okay if you have z if you have a wave along z then you can have a wave equation which will be perfectly of this order if the polarization is along x or if the polarization is along y which are the principal axes they are like like these two polarization directions will satisfy the wave equation in the form that I wrote and in that case the principal I mean the direction of E and the direction of D will be parallel however if you have if the propagation is along an arbitrary direction then of course your E will not be parallel to D but then you will resolve it into two orthogonal D vectors that is crucial what we are trying to say is that if you come with a case so what we just showed here is that if you have a wave that is polarized that is sorry propagating along one principal axis direction say and the propagation and then the if you have the polarizations along the one of those two orthogonal principal axes then you are essentially having the like this whole description that we said that is completely valid with the E being taken we don't need to go to the D picture okay but then if we are not considering that if it's an arbitrary direction then the wave equation we wrote last time that is what we have to consider and what is crucial is it is then the E will not be parallel to D but however you will have the D's will still be perpendicular to each other so it will basically get resolved into two perpendicular orthogonal polarizations okay and we typically project them along the two principal axes
okay
it's a superposition of these two
like why didn't you like write the equation in terms of the I mean why did we write del E by del Z we should have written del D by del Z right
in the sense that see that is so what see one thing is that we sort of wrote the yesterday we did so yeah so one thing is that you know I mean you had a far more so we wrote the wave equation yesterday right so that was like del square E minus del del it is a much more complicated wave equation so you will not have the wave equation that I had now see that del dot E term will come and it will get much more complicated right so this right. simple wave equation that you wrote will only be valid when this description is correct
okay
you understand only when this direction with the actual wave equation we wrote last class right that from where we constructed that equation of that that is basically the your refractive in your ellipsoid your this index ellipsoid that is essentially nothing but the index ellipsoid which we will discuss after we but essentially that wave equation is one thing right so to reduce to this simple equation only if you have this kind of a propagation
okay I get that we are trying to simplify our
calculus simplify the things
but from here we can just conclude that the orthogonal components are of E and not D how can we comment anything on D
because no the are being able to write the way so basically now it's a simple because now you are you see if axis then your E is epsilon constant right D is just this is fine no
sir I couldn't hear last 1 minute
your so what I oh again oh so basically what I'm saying is if you are having if you are basically in the principle, you are along this principle axis, everything is along the one of the principle axis, then dx and ex are related by a constant, no? Because there is nothing else. The direction is only along this.
Okay, so basically we are going to a simpler case.
Exactly. Simple. Yeah. Okay. The only thing is that both are allowed. So you can have a thing which is coming in the x direction, both the polarization, or sorry, z direction, polarization along x and polarization along y, principal axis, they are equivalent in the sense that they will, both of these cases will lead to a valid wave. That is what I'm trying to say. So the phase velocities will be different, but it's a valid wave equation of the simple form that we know earlier for an isotropic medium. Okay, the typical anisotropic wave equation is much more complicated because the del del dot E, that term is non-vanishing. However, if you consider this kind of a system, then the wave equation basically, when the anisotropic media acts like an isotropic media, essentially the crux of the discussion is this.
Right. Got
it. When does anisotropic media generally can, when can it be put in the framework of isotropic media? That is the whole crux of this discussion. And this is important for us to spend some time on this, because the textbooks don't say at all anything. Why we are doing this, they don't say. They just do things one after the other. So this is a crucial discussion. Why are we doing this? We are basically doing this to show when your anisotropic media can be thought of in the framework of isotropic media, only if this happens. Okay. So basically what we are saying is, if propagation is along an arbitrary direction, then your in the crystal, that's obviously in the crystal, then E is not parallel to D, obviously, and that is quite clear, right? Or you have like, then you have like Di equal to epsilon ij ej and all that is perfectly fine. This is not going to be the same. Now, however, what we need to look at is, as we said, the angular relationship between D for an arbitrary wave vector. Relationship between the D's for a particular wave vector or whatever, or a particular wave vector. Okay, so basically, and this is why this is coming, because we saw that you in principle can have two possible velocities, right? One was this v1 and the other was v2, right? So what we can write is dj1 equal to some kj p1 square. This is from that relationship, say vj square minus v1 square. This is one of the roots, okay? And we have a dj2, which is kj pj square by, again, vj square minus v2 square. And your j is the principal axis, basically. Okay, so now see, what I'm trying to do is, this is that resolution into principal axis type of thing, right? So we saw that there are possibly, you can have your two solutions, N1 and N2, right? So I can put that as either N1 or N2, both are possible, because I have two roots, right? So essentially I'm saying that because I have two roots, I can project them in, I can essentially write down the relationship from what we got for D. Okay, so now I want to take a dot product and see what is happening. Okay, what is happening between, say, this dj1 dot dj2 when you do, what will essentially happen? That is what I want to see. Okay.
Sir, isn't that p2 square?
Sorry?
In the second equation, is that pj square or p2 square?
P2. Oh, I don't. Oh, sorry. 1 minute. Okay, so, yeah. So essentially, these are the two directions of D which are allowed for a particular wave vector. Okay. So where is it going? ओह आई डोंट पीजे. अच्छा. So basically, remember, so we are essentially trying to find out, the particular allowed directions D1 and D2. Okay, so basically D1 and D2 are, why are D1 and D2 different? Because you have two possible phase velocities possible, right? And we are seeing that the inherent polarization directions, however, essentially we want to see that these two will get, these are normalized, I mean, sorry, these are orthogonal or not. Okay, so that means if I want to do d1 dot d2 vector, that is just going to be summed over all this, right? Summed over j, some kind of kj square, p1 square, p2 square, divided by vj minus v1 square, oh, vj square, into vj square minus v2 square. Okay, so these are all possible these things, orientation. I'm just summing, this is a dot product, so I'm essentially going to sum over all the possible projections in the principal axis. Okay, that will essentially be the dot product. This is absolutely fine, right? So now you can see this is very easy to write down. This guy, I can just break this up. If I have vj square minus v1 square, I can essentially write this out up as, so p1 p2 are constants not being summed, so I can take those outside. P1 square p2 square I can take outside. Now think of this, I can essentially write this as this very important, just note this step. Right? Is this fine? This is fine, right? Because when I do the subtraction, then you have a view, the vj will cancel up. Okay, I mean, that will cancel out in the numerator. You have a v2 square minus v1 square. It will cancel with this, right? Fine. Now, obviously, now what is this? What is this? Summation of kj squared over v1 square minus vj square individually?
No, zero.
Exactly. This is zero. This is also zero. Fantastic. So that is beautiful, right? This is actually telling you that you are essentially having two unique orthogonal polarization directions with different phase velocities. And exactly this is the physics behind all kinds of birefringent crystals. This is what happens. For you, it is less complicated because you have like just basically, you know, there is one optic axis and one other, you know, this thing, the extraordinary or ordinary or whatever they say, you know, one different. I mean, typically you just have two different refractive indices, N1, N2, but then there are, if you have lower symmetry, then you have much more complicated stuff. But essentially, this is exactly what happens. You come with a input vector that gets divided into two different, I mean, you can get essentially different phase velocities with respect to the principal axis. Okay, so this implies that D vectors are orthogonal for an arbitrary direction of polarization, extremely important. Very, very important. Okay, so this is basically the crux. This is what anisotropic media is all about. This is the full, you know, this is, and it's very nice because the theory, you know, and as again, I really find this very beautiful because you don't need any, and this construction is so clean. I mean, there is no, you do not have to, because what we typically, what you have read, studied till now is just descriptive, that you are told that, you know, that the birefringent crystal has two axes, that you never, it was like, you know, this is the math, this is the real physics, this is what is happening. This is exactly what is happening, and very, very systematic. Okay. And one final thing, you've already understood this, but I think it is important still to write down, that is the angular relation between, so what is where, that is very important, D, E, H, K, and S. This is very crucial. S is the pointing vector. Very important. But then these are very simple derivatives. So we know from the what we wrote down last time that this was there. Okay. And we know that del del t is, of course, I omega. We know that. And we also know that any del cross basically is nothing but I k cross, right? Which is fine. So del cross e will be I k cross e. So del del t is I omega and del cross is I k cross. Okay, del cross. So this is well known. So now suppose, I should actually not write del d del t. I think that's not fair. If somebody can tell me how to lower this size of the eraser, I will give you a treat. Very irritating. So now suppose we just take this. Which obviously implies that E cross K is omega B and minus K cross H is omega D. And we also, which obviously means that H cross K is omega D, right? So very clearly, so I think it's quite obvious there, but I think the diagram is what we are going to look at, but H is perpendicular to D and K, and E is also perpendicular to B and K, but they are not in the same direction. That is very crucial, right? So now just think of this. So basically, if you just write, you know, so you, we know that, of course, this, so your del dot E or whatever, so that is just minus A I K dot E. But so what we are trying to say is that if alpha is the, if angle, what did I write, man? If alpha is the angle between D and E, then what you basically have is cos of alpha is E dot D by this, right? And that means alpha is cos inverse, just what we should write is epsilon E dot epsilon R E by E D. This is useful. I think what is crucial is that S, which is E cross H, very crucially, is perpendicular to both E and H, but not in the direction of K. Is very crucial, extremely important, because we are essentially seeing that, so you know that in isotropic media, and that is only because E and H are not orthogonal. Essentially, E and H are not orthogonal. That is the main reason, right? It's basically tilted. So they are a coplanar, but they are basically tilted. Then S and K are coplanar, but they are not at the same angle as each other, right? So what we finally, I'll just give you this picture, which will be very clear to you. I think it's better to give it from the book because I will completely mess up the drawing. 1 minute, just give me a second. Just a minute. Ah, I messed up now. So, just give me a second. So basically, this is what you're going to have. Okay. So let me just go. This is what we have. This is the picture in anisotropic media. This is what we have in anisotropic media. Very, very important that the energy direction is not along K. It's extremely important. So any comments about this? This is clear, right? This whole thing appears basically because of this. I mean, yeah, this angle between E and D. And of course, between B and H, all of them, right? So what we can summarize, therefore, very important, I think we have understood this. So you have, so basically what we described till now is something which is called a uniaxial crystal. Okay, we are going to have it in more detail later on. But so in general, we have two allowed directions of polarization with distinct phase velocities. Within a uniaxial crystal. This is basically the detail that we have done is this, okay? And if the polarization of a wave corresponds to one of them, the wave propagates with the, let me zoom out a bit, with the phase velocity corresponding to that polarization. But for arbitrary polarization, this is the crucial part, but for arbitrary polarization, the resultant will be split into two, which actually will be resolved, whatever, split into two orthogonal, I should not say resultant, the polarization. the polarization two orthogonal, actually the wave, it's better to say the wave will be split into two orthogonal linear polarizations with different phase velocities. This is the main physics. Okay, this is the main thing that we have. Okay, so this is, I think I will let you chew on this. We will, actually, yeah, why is it not, why can I not expand this? Oh. This can't be, something is crazy is happening here. Anyway, I think this is big enough. Why can I not make this bigger? Anyway, so any comments on this, guys? Yeah? Are you with me?
Sir.
Yeah.
This we have concluded on the basis that by assuming that the Maxwell's equations are written in D and H and not D and B, right?
Yes. Concluded, but that has to be right, because that is what we saw, because your K is now perpendicular to D. It is not perpendicular to E anymore. Right? Because of the simple thing that K dot D is zero.
Actually, it is not very evident, because whenever we have seen Maxwell's equations, we always saw in terms of E and B, and now suddenly we are writing.
No, the reason that you see again, Rohan, is basically because your epsilon now is a function of space. It's a function of space, right?
Yes, I get that.
So the moment is a function of space, then D is a more sort of, it's like, you know, in quantum mechanics, we say what is a good quantum number or something like that, right? So here we can say that the good descriptor of the wave-like property, where we have the wave perpendicular, the wave direction. See, essentially for a wave, we have the wave direction perpendicular to an electric field, some field. The direction is, for any transverse wave, the direction in which the wave moves is perpendicular to a field. Here we are saying it is not the incident field, or it is not the electric field which is crucial, but the displacement field, which is falling into that framework that we know of transverse fields. So for transverse fields, we always have some field and the propagation direction perpendicular to it. We see that a good choice for, you know, the only choice for fulfilling that is when we consider the displacement field, or the field which is brought about by the bound electrons, which are a crucial part of the medium. And what we are saying is that the velocities of the electrons are now essentially resolved differently in three different directions. Of course, they are all different if you don't resolve into principal axis, then they are arbitrarily all different. I mean, they are like all nine, whatever, they are much more complicated. But because of the fact that we have a symmetric tensor, we show that, because, you know, we have to, obey the continuity equation, therefore they have to be sort of, the epsilons are all symmetric, and we are able to diagonalize that. So basically, we are now possible to give a simpler, in fact, this, if you say this is some way, this is like an eigenvector problem, right?
Right.
Very close to an eigenvector
problem. We are going to such a basis that our lives become easier.
Exactly. This is exactly an eigenvector problem.
Okay.
And when we will see that, you know, see, I think you guys should appreciate by now that polarization algebra, all this polarization optics, is nothing but what you have in quantum mechanics. It's exactly the same. It is exactly the same. But when we will, you know, all the Jones matrices, right? They are nothing but your spin odds. All your sigma x, sigma y, sigma z that you have in your, when you describe photon quantum, this thing, right? Photon spin. Right, it is exactly the same as polarization. It is that. It is exactly that. In fact, I think Dirac algebra was. Dirac took all the algebra from here, actually. Bishwajit.
Yeah. No, I said that. It is not. How is it? Rohan. Rohan said that. No. If you take carefully about that Maxwell equation. Many book and even they when they choose E, that they said that this is for homogeneous, linear,
yeah,
and isotropic medium.
Yes, yes, very crucial.
That is true.
Very crucial.
Yes, that's
very
the,
crucial.
And homogeneous
crucial.
And linear and isotropic.
Isotropic. Extremely crucial.
Then it is in the terms of E.
Yes. So let me just then write down for maybe for an isotropic media. Let me just write down. So in isotropic media, S is in the direction of K, which is not, however, not so for anisotropic media. Okay, so this is important, and you can see Konstantin Bliok argues that Poynting vector is a useless quantity. He wants to just go into this canonical momentum and all. So there, actually, you know, if you go to that sort of description of wave optics, all these will not be rendered important, actually, because Poynting vector is something that we construct, which is very useful to understand isotropic paraxial optics. But when we break all that, I think Poynting vector, it's not, yeah, I mean, it's still, but it's an important thing, because you can say that this is still the energy flow. Yeah, it is kind of, it is, this is very interesting, actually, right? This energy flow is actually somewhat different from this. That is interesting, actually. That only happens because of the anisotropy of the system. Okay, so I will recommend that. I think this part is very new. Again, you guys have not done this. I think you know, have not, not I think, I know you have not done it before. And you have, I think, still encountered this, however, a lot of times when you have done all kinds of, you know, polarization stuff, at least experiments you have done. And I think I covered a bit of polarization in your second year course as well. But those who did the Stokes vector experiment and that this no, only Stokes. No, you had that in Poincaré sphere, that this one also was there, no? In that geometric phase, there was a description of the Poincaré sphere. But those who did the SLM experiment, they had to completely deal with Stokes vectors and all that. So you have done your, I think, quarter wave phase, you guys have handled quite a bit. Second year, third year, both you handled. But then this is really the physics of that, of these, any kind of, you know, polarization modifying. Because remember, a polarizer is certainly not this. It's basically only things which are birefringent, which are anisotropic media, which can actually rotate polarization. A polarizer that cannot rotate polarization. Polarizer just gives you certain component of light, which is in the direction of the polarization of the polarizer. It will basically just give you that. So polarizer is basically something which reduces intensity, it changes intensity. But crucially, you know, these polarization rotators or these kind of polarization optics, when we say polarization optics, they in principle will not change the intensity. They will only rotate the polarization. So half wave wave, quarter wave wave will not change any intensity at all, unless you put a polarizer at the back end. Okay, that is crucial. But what is important here is this is the reason, this is all, and this is extremely similar to an eigenvalue problem in quantum mechanics. Okay, so when we resume, we shall just wind up stuff, you know, we'll finish this index ellipsoid. I think we have already covered that somewhat, but that is exactly, you know, that surface when we define the constant energy surface, that is indeed the ellipsoid. But we will, I think we have to refresh this part a bit, but I will request you to look at. So I think the assignment date is day after tomorrow. So do you want some assignment in the week, in the holiday?
No, sir.
Sir, we already have got many projects, many assignments.
No, but you guys start. So I request, earnestly request, that please start studying for your presentation. Because, okay, so some dates and all logistics, let us discuss a little bit before we wind up. So I think the DOA gave us, so in the Senate meeting, I think we got some date of 2nd to 15th December as the exams. So since we are not holding exams here, you guys have to, once you get the routine, see, I hope to, so 27th November is supposed to be the last day of class. But
can you inform the ACAD office that you do not want to conduct an end semester? That way,
why is that necessary?
Because if you inform that I don't want to conduct an exam while making the end sem timetable, they won't.
Oh, yeah. That is important. That is a good statement. Yes, right.
So
I need to do that.
I'm actually getting this from all the instructors.
I need to do that. Sure. I forgot. Yeah. Yes, I should do that. Yes.
So if we have many such instructors,
then you exactly. So any others who are not taking exam for fourth year, fifth year?
Quantum field theory, we do not have an end semester.
Quantum field theory is whose?
Kaushik Datta.
Okay, good. Yeah, he told me he's taking lot of these assignments and tests and all that. No.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And I think there's one more course, space astronomy.
But he might take a 25-30 mark exam or something. No.
We are taking many tests, so he's
not the final exam. Okay. That I think most people. Is anybody taking a final exam at fourth year? I mean, final exam, I think very few people will take.
Endurance matter, sir. Kamaraju, sir.
Oh, he's going to take final exam. Okay.
Yes. He may even take Viva as well.
Oh, both? Wow, that is remarkable.
Sir, Rohan, I just want to be clarified. When they said 2nd December, 15th December, the final exams have to be there.
Hmm.
Do they mean like normal 3-hour final exams have to
be
there?
No, that is up to the instructor. Completely up to the instructor.
Yeah.
Okay, but whatever final assessment, those 50 marks should be done with dates. Like that's
something like that.
I think they're also bound to the end semester exam that they
15. That I don't know. I don't think they've put this thing.
I think it's 30.
Yeah, that I don't know. That was it discussed? I don't remember. Achha, ek cheez then. So do you think we'll have, so I think the grade submission they have said is 21st December for us. Okay.
Maybe
the presentations, what do you want to do? Do you want to hold them from maybe whatever during after all the exams but you don't have the dates, no?
Personally, I would like after the exam.
Yeah, I know, yes, but then what will the dates be? How many exams will you have?
That is not sure, sir, as of now.
We have how many groups? Bishwajit, how many groups do you have? Have you seen?
No, 18. Maybe.
18 groups? Oh, wow. Oh, God. That means we will take at least 4-5 days, no? Oh, that is a lot of groups, actually. Okay. 18 groups, are you sure?
I'm checking.
Okay, so then we need 6. So because that Viva also, then to total then we need a long time actually. Okay, so let me get out of this.
19.
Huh?
19 groups.
Man, you guys all
this is
single presentation.
This is exactly the reason I was saying that this semester should not end on 27th. But I don't know why the Senate has decided that it should end on 27th
November. No, but see, there's a lot of flexibility in the classes actually. So people told that I think it was clearly said that if you are not taking NSEM exams, then you can continue. It was clearly said.
Okay.
It was clearly said that if you don't take NSEM exams, you can continue. So once you get the routine, I will of course indicate that I am not taking NSEM. So once you get the routine, then we will just prepare. So maybe then I think we'll have to change the class timings also. Okay. So if we see that there is an exam happening, maybe 2 days I will give. So accordingly, we'll be a bit flexible. Because otherwise, we are getting less time, no? Because typically we have like 38-40 classes. This time we are getting less classes then, no? That is very problematic actually. This is taking more time.
No, sir. Actually, we have completed around 27 classes as of today.
Not 27, man.
And
Rohan, I can't.
Sir, I write.
Huh?
Sir, I write lecture number every day. This is 27th lecture.
So many?
Yeah, we took 27 lectures.
Bapre. Yeah. Are you sure? Let me count. Okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. September, there are 11. August, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. See, 18. Okay, October. Oh, you are correct, I think. Oh, shit. No, you are not correct. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 3, 4, 5, 6. 23. 23.
I don't know.
In August, there was class.
August, I calculated. No.
Oh, you calculated.
8, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 in August. Okay. September, we counted 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11. So 80, 11 plus 7, 18. Right? And October, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6. Today is 7. Okay, 20. Oh, no, we had those discussion. Ah, yeah, that is correct, 27. Because there was one presentation and one this thing.
Right.
One, classes are yeah. 24 model. And then Drude those model, extras model, were a discussion.
No, but see, online will take time, right? Because online is not a good way of teaching, I think. I mean, in the sense that it takes more time doing this because I am, you know, I really feel that it is not easy to understand things. It's very easy to keep concentration. So I don't want to go too much in online.
So it's not good for teaching and neither for learning.
I know, but see, but if I go fast, then it will become meaningless, right? Then I will just, I mean, what? It doesn't make any sense. I'll just upload whatever notes and say, padlo. What is the big deal? That is absolutely useless, no?
You can safely say that the number is like 1.2 to 1.4 times the actual classes required for online.
It should be, right? Huh? Then we are fine. That's what I'm saying. So anyway, so let us make a deal like this. So once we you get the routine, okay, accordingly, we'll have to be flexible. So because see, I think you need to learn. Yeah, you don't need to mug up at all in this course, right? You need to learn. And if you want to learn, then we will cover stuff, right? Because I want to really cover everything that is required, as I said, to trap a particle. Okay, we have covered now almost quite a bit of thing, quite a few things. But Jones Muller, do you think we need to spend time or that part you are guys are okay?
That is fine, sir.
Jones Muller is not
second year
too much.
Muller is third year as well.
So then what I will do is that Jones Muller, I will probably just maybe upload some notes or something and we can directly go to this ABCT matrices for cavity and all. So maybe one class we'll do for Jones and Muller. I think Jones Muller you have done many times. I taught you once. Then
and
you
then
guys
in
have
second, a third year lab as well.
No, but third year lab, it is the problem is not everybody did. No.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah, like we weren't taught. We have to learn ourselves also because it was hard.
No, but Nirmala sir gave lecture like on the first day of.
So everybody did those lectures, no? I think most of you did those lectures, right?
Yeah, okay. But then again, those were brief and not.
See, because Jones Muller straight to do three class lag jaga if you do the whole thing. You straight take three classes.
We can spend one class on like Stokes vectors and that stuff.
Just me, so I will give you some maybe see that Nirmalo's chapter that is I think one of you is giving talk also is somebody giving talks on talk on that Bishwajit on polarization optics did you by is somebody okay very few people are there today where are the I don't okay so is that thing is shared no I can myself open no shared with me where is it
can see the screen. Oh, wait.
Wait, where is that? You guys put it. I don't remember where it was.
Sir, I've sent the link in the chat box.
Did you send? Okay, 1 minute.
Yes, sir.
Oh, chat box you have sent. Huh? Chat box to good. Okay, okay, good.
In that, that good classroom good. Folder.
Oh, classroom folder, right. Laser cooling, microscopy, surface plasma, me scattering. Oh, nobody is giving on.
Sir, just a question. Why is the group 7 doing two topics?
because they are three people. I gave them three people is not fair, no?
Oh, okay.
Three people. Hey, nobody is talking on Stokes-Muller, is it? Oh, shit.
Sir, then it's technically 20 groups.
Yeah.
Sir, are you sharing your screen? Because I can't see.
Oh, you want to see? I am not sharing. Wait, I will share if you want. Will, do you want to share? Okay, I will share it. What is this? This one I have to share, no? This. Can you see?
Yes, sir.
Nobody is talking on Stokes-Muller, Muller matrix at all. Oh, God. Nobody is talking on Muller matrix. No. Nobody is talking on Muller. Then though I should take some classes actually. I thought somebody would talk on Muller matrix. Let me see. So what I will do is I think you should get some. This will take long time. I will give you some assignments. So ye thoda tum log pad lo. I will maybe spend maybe maximum two classes. Two classes also is a lot. Okay. Maximum two classes on this. Because then, see, there is a lot of completely new stuff in ABCD matrices, which you guys absolutely don't know. So this one was something you don't know, but we have a little bit left in that. But then this Stokes-Muller takes a long time. So see, uniaxial, all this, we can finish this in one class. Okay. Then Jones-Muller, I will just give an overview. Okay. Just overview. And then we'll give an assignment where you do some self-study and learn this Stokes-Muller. I will say spend some time on how you sort of measured them experimentally. That I will spend time. Okay. And then we will jump to resonators because that is something which you absolutely don't know. It's totally new. Okay. How you describe optical elements and all and resonator stability. That is a very beautiful thing because that is how every laser works. Okay. So that is the plan. And once you get the routine, then we will accord. So, okay. There are 20 groups every day. If you have like four, five, so we shall try to start once all your exams are done, in which case, hopefully that we'll again see. If your exam is ending on 14th, then there is two less time because viva bhi hai na, viva we can try to finish in 3 days maybe. Okay, so five viva there are 30 something. Oh, 4 days we need. Let me see,
sir. We can utilize the tutorials to give presentations towards the end.
See, my only concern is if you have exams, I want to space them up. Ideally, suppose your exam is over on 10th, suppose fourth year exams are done by 10th, then we have a solid like 10 days left. Okay, then we have the presentations in say 5 days and the viva in 4 days. I have 1 day to grade.
Actually, what my thought was, I will ask all the instructors who want to conduct an exam and push all the exam dates towards the end of 15th. So that we get time to teach.
Then that is okay. So class, though, I think I will try to. I think was 7th December. Tak I will work over. First week of December, we will take. Okay. Only thing is, presentations can we start during the teaching? That also is possible. Maybe that also we can do. We can start some presentations while the course is going on.
Yes.
Okay. Because this is, I think that is ideal. Okay, so we will start the presentations during the course happening. Okay, so let us stop today. Holiday to anyway, holiday ho raha hai, but keep safe because I think we are going to get a worse second wave. I mean, we are already not out of the first wave, but the second wave, I mean, people who are living in the north is going to be very bad, and in Bengal as well. Maharashtra is probably better now. I don't think, because Dasera Vasera is not too strong in Maharashtra.
Sir, okay. You never know.
I'm stopping recording. Yeah, that is a brief. That I know.